Hi, I'm Tyro Man. I'm at New York Comic Con 2015, and I'm talking with Jerry the King Lawler. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing great, Tyro Man. This is one of the thrills of my life. I've heard so much about you over the years. You know, you hear about Superman, you hear about Batman, but I was always curious about Tyro Man. And now, finally, I get to meet you. But still, I'm still going to be wondering about your secret identity.
Well, that's got to keep secret.
It's got to stay secret, right?
It's got to stay secret.
Okay. Well, Tyro Man, we're here at New York City Comic Con, and this is awesome. A lot of people here, a lot of characters. And when I first saw you walk by, I just thought you were one of these guys that are doing the cosplay. But no, you're out here fighting crime, right?
Yeah, I'm actual superhero.
He's actual superhero. Yeah. That's right. Awesome.
Trying to do media in the right way, you know?
Yeah.
Someone has to do it.
I know. Now, look, when you talk, do you need to hold the microphone close to you?
Yes.
You need to do it like this, right?
Yeah. Okay.
I learned that early in my career as a radio broadcaster.
Yeah.
Okay, what are we talking about, Tyro Man?
So I want to hear a little bit about your career. You were a wrestler for many years.
Yes, many years. 45 years, as a matter of fact, I've been wrestling. I'm tired. I'm tired, Tyro Man. I'm not a superhero like you. Just a regular guy that became a wrestler and have had thousands of matches and won more titles than any other wrestler in the history of the business. 168 championships. And now I'm the host of Thursday Night SmackDown on the Sci-Fi Network. And a lot of people have come through. And, you know, for 20-something years, 20-plus years, I hosted Monday Night Raw on the USA Network. Now I've switched to SmackDown on Sci-Fi, Thursday night, 8 p.m., and a lot of people come by and say, why don't you commentate anymore? And just because a lot of them apparently didn't know that I switched, and so they thought when I wasn't on Raw anymore, I was out of the business. But they say, why did you switch? And I said, to make SmackDown better. So now I'm on the best show, Thursday night SmackDown, Sci-Fi. You love it, don't you, Tyro Man?
One of the best shows out there.
What?
One of the best shows out there.
Okay, I'm glad you do. Now, I'm going to ask you a question, Tyro Man. What's your favorite thing here at the Comic Con other than me?
Comics.
You like comics?
I'm big into comics.
I can't get him to get this concept down yet. That's okay. Can you still hear him when he's got the microphone pointed toward me? Okay.
Yeah,
so what's your favorite comic, Tyro Man?
I like the team comics. X-Men, Avengers, Justice League.
So what's better, the DC Justice League or the Marvel Avengers?
It all depends on who's writing. It's always the writer, the stories.
It's about storylines and writers.
Yes.
So in other words, you don't think of these as real people.
No.
You don't? But you're a real person, aren't you?
I am.
You're a real superhero, right?
Yeah.
What's your favorite superpower that a superhero has?
I think flight would be pretty awesome to have. I don't have that power myself. But.
Oh, flight would be awesome. X-ray vision would be fun.
Yeah.
Fun. X-ray vision would be especially fun at this New York City Comic Con. What would you do if you had X-ray vision?
I don't think I want it.
Let's not talk
I can't
about
soil my
You know
reputation.
What would be cool to be like invisible sometime, too?
Invisible would be a good thing.
Yeah. And now, the Invisible Man, he wasn't a superhero, was he?
No. I remember the movie. He was kind of a villain.
I remember when the Invisible Man married the Invisible Woman, and their kids were nothing to look at either. But anyway, look at this guy over here. He's kind of scary looking, isn't he, Tyro Man?
He is.
Okay.
I got to keep an eye on him.
Let's definitely keep an eye on him. Now, what else you want to talk about? We've talked enough about wrestling. What about my artwork and my comic books? You like comic books?
Yeah.
I've done the artwork on the Headlock comic books. Now, maybe hand me a Headlock comic book. Look at this poor, beautiful young lady here working hard. The guy can't move the camera. He's just stuck. It's just, no, never mind. Don't try. This is called Headlock Comic. It's a comic book written by Mike Kingston. Is that better? How's that? It's a comic book written by Mike Kingston, and I drew the cover for it. I did the artwork for the cover of this. And it's about a young man who's trying to break into the wrestling business, and it shows you a lot of the behind the scenes and what goes on, and the underlying things that you have to go through to get into the wrestling business. It's a really neat book. It's got some good storylines. Yeah.
I love the cover, how you did the throwback to like Saturday Night Post.
It's like a Saturday Evening Post. That came out before Saturday Night Post. And this is you're right. It's an old Norman. Excuse me.
Norman Rockwell.
This must have been that. tacos I had for lunch. But anyway, it's a throwback to a Norman Rockwell cover. And the next one that's coming out is also another throwback to the Norman Rockwell cover. I'm a big Norman Rockwell fan. As a matter of fact, last Wednesday, I spent the entire day in Norman Rockwell's home in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, going through his museum, actually visiting his gravesite. And if you're ever in Stockbridge, Mass, go see the Norman Rockwell Museum. Go see his home where he lived, the Red Lion Inn, Main Street of Stockbridge. It's a famous painting in itself. Yep. And then the cemetery where Norman is buried. So, this is a fun piece. And if you get a chance, get yourself a Headlocked Comic.
Headlocked
Comic. Tyler, man, you don't talk a lot. You're a man of few words.
I am.
Why is that?
I let the guests do the talking.
Oh.
Because it's really all about the guests.
Well, have I done enough talking for you, Tyro Man?
Well, do you want to tell us about your video? Or?
Nah.
Okay.
WWE put out after only been there 23 years, and they finally came out with a Jerry Lawler DVD, and it tells my entire life story. It's called It's Good to Be the King.
If people want to follow you online, you have a website?
If people want to follow me online, I'm on all of social media. I have a website, which is kingjerrylawler.com. I am at Twitter. It's at Jerry Lawler. That's tough to remember, isn't it?
Yeah.
And what else? Facebook. I'm not too much into Facebook. Are you?
I try to update it, but it's time-consuming. I don't have time.
Does anybody still do MySpace? That's gone, isn't it?
Yeah, MySpace seems to...
I wanted to combine MySpace and Facebook and call it MyFace. But that didn't fly.
Yeah. Good idea, though. I like it.
You like that?
I like it. Well, thank you for taking time to talk to us. It's awesome.
Well, Tyro Man, this has been a thrill. You can't imagine how overjoyed I've been at being here, a guest on your show. When's this going to air?
In a few months.
Yeah. Well, actually, it's airing now when you're seeing it, but this was probably done then a few months ago.
Yes.
Now, Tyro Man, is this going to be one of those things where you do reruns? Do you ever re-show a show over and over again?
Oh, yeah.
So this may be on in perpetuity.
Yeah, we put up on YouTube. It's up on
YouTube.
So people come and watch it all the time. People are like, I want to check in on you. Watch it.
Let's combine YouTube and Facebook and call it, MySpace and YouTube and call it MyTube. Would that be work?
No.
Your tube and my tube. Well.
YouTube, my tube.
My girlfriend here says they just opened the door to the men's room, so I got to go. Tyro Man.
Okay. Thanks again.
It's been exciting.
Yes.
You have a tremendous amount of charisma. That be what draws people to you, Tyro Man.
Yeah, I try.
Look at that. Look at that smile. So now what do we do? How do we sign off on these shows?
We just say, tune in next time on Tyro TV. Hi, Tyro Man. I'm at New York Comic Con 2015, and I'm talking with Anita Clay. How are you doing, Anita?
Hi, I'm doing well. Great to hear from you guys. How are you?
Good. Having a good time here at New York Comic Con.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's been a really, really fun time for me so far. I can't complain at all.
Now, you're involved in a web series, mm-hmm. Genocide. You want to tell us about it?
Well, Genocide it has a very powerful name, so everybody's like, ooh, Genocide, what is that?
Yeah.
Well, it's a futuristic sci-fi web series. It's also 3D animation. Oh, and cool. My main character is Nisa Emery, and my character starts in the future, and she kind of realizes that, you know, everybody's kind of the same. You know, like, there's no variation in color for people, no light skin, no dark skin. And, you know, she starts to wonder why that is. And so she starts asking questions, and she's kind of met with very, like, strict rules. Like, don't ever ask those questions. Nobody wants to know about it. So in the future, you know, technology is much better. So we're allowed to go from the future back to the past. But it's kind of one of those... regulated government thing. So you can only do it if the government says that it's okay. Well, unfortunately, it's not okay for my character to go back to the past to find out why, and I do it illegally. The government finds out, and they send drones after me to kind of stop me either to kill me or bring me back. Nobody really knows exactly what's going to happen just yet. So my character is in the past basically trying to find out like why they have darker shade people, African Americans in zoos, and why, you know, why things are the way that they are now. And then she's going to try back, you know, to go back into the past and find out why and how to stop it, how to make, you know, make it better for the future.
Right.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's kind of action-packed. You know, I get to kick butt, you know, and I, my production company is Trooper Touch Film Entertainment, and we are kind of like a group of girls. We're called the Angels of Action, and we all specialize in martial arts, but we also specialize in weapons as well. And we each have our own specialized weapon for our characters.
Nice.
Yeah, mine's the Eskrimas, you know, the Filipino fighting sticks. So I'm very excited. You actually get to see me fight with them in Genocide. So I'm excited for that.
Yeah. Yeah. And so what website would people go to view this? Like, how would I find this?
Well, I think the best place to go right now is to ASC Productions, which is the name of the production company that also works with Trooper Touch Film Entertainment. You can also Google the Urban Action Showcase Expo, which is the production company's film festival where we celebrate diversity in action as well as women in action. So there's a lot of really cool things that go on with it. Yeah, yeah, we got like our whole martial arts family going on. It's cool.
Now, you also said that you also do some hosting for...
I do. I host mixtapekings.com. I don't know if you guys, any of you hip-hop heads out there are watching. Hi, it's your girl, Anita Clay. And, yeah, this is my other job. I'm an actress. I'm a hostess. You know, I also have done production. I've done, you know, kind of like videography. I also do editing, you know, like...
You wear many hats?
Yeah, an artist all the way around, you know.
Nice.
Yeah.
Which job do you find the most rewarding? Like, which one do you find most rewarding?
Well... Of course, being a film star is always has its like rewards, you know, and it's something that I've always wanted to do. It's something that, you know, like I used to watch people on, you know, TV and be like, I could do that. I could be one of those people. And, you know, so I've been working towards that for the past like 8 years or so. And I would say the most rewarding is actually living out my dream, you know, to whatever extent it may be. I don't have to be famous. Just as long as, you know, I'm doing film, I'm working on films, I'm in films, you know, whatever it may be, behind the camera, in front of the camera, it really doesn't matter to me, to be honest. I just love film. That's it.
Film is fun.
Yeah. Yeah. And but, you know, I would say being an actor is its most has its most rewards just because you're always studying and you're always learning something new. So, you know, like, for instance, before I started working with Trooper Touch Film Entertainment, I wasn't studying martial arts. You know, it's just kind of, like, came with the job. And it's something that I always wanted to do. So I was like, let me try it. Let me see if I can do it. And here I am doing it. And so that's, it's just a reward in its own, you know. You know, it's like I'm happy. I'm happy where I'm at. I'm happy and excited, you know, to see how things, you know, unfold. So, yeah.
Is that the most rewarding part of the job?
Absolutely, because you can always walk away with that skill, you know, whether or not the job, you know, pans out to be something that you expected it to be, you learn something new. So for me, that's the most rewarding thing that you can have, because you can always use it for something else. You know, the more skills you have, the more valuable you are. That's the way it works.
Yeah. What advice would you give to somebody trying to get into acting or starting out?
Well, I would say the first and very most thing that I tell anybody who wants to be an actor, go to class, practice, act, do it. Don't talk about doing it. Don't dream about doing it. Do it. Don't think about it. Just do it. You know, you might not be good the first time you do it. Nobody really ever is. But the more you practice, the better you get at stuff. You know, and so if you want to be an actor, you want to get into the industry, go to class. That's the first step.
Who are some of your favorite actors or actresses?
Well, I have always been an action head. So, Jackie Chan. I love Jackie Chan. I love Bruce Lee, you know. Females, Cynthia Rothrock. I used to grow up watching Cynthia Rothrock when I was a little kid. I used to try and do her scorpion kick on my cousins.
You know? Take a turn.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm like, let me see if this works. Not really.
Just stand there.
Just get kicked in the head. It's okay. So, Who else would I say is a good example? Well, Lauren Velez, she's actually not an action star. She's just an actress, but she's Latina American. And I, as a Latin American, I'm half Puerto Rican. You know, I'm mixed with a whole bunch of other stuff, but I would say I identify mostly with the Latin culture. She has been a really great inspiration just to see, like, yeah, there are people out there that look like me and that they're doing it. So if they can do it, I can do it too, you know, and the door's wide open, you know, there's nobody telling me I can't. So I like seeing other people who are working in that industry who look like me, you know, kind of understand where I'm coming from, understand my culture, understand, you know, the way that I'm thinking. And, you know, just to see, like, okay, you know, there's space for everybody. And, you know, that makes me happy. Yeah.
Well, thanks for taking time to talk to us. I do appreciate
it. Yeah,
absolutely.
Awesome and
helpful.
Thank you, darling. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Hi,
I'm Tom and I'm at New York Comic Con 2015, and I'm talking with Jun Kiwaimi.
Jun Imaizumi.
Hi, nice to meet you. And he is the head developer and producer for Phantom of the Guild. Can you tell us a little bit about the game?
Phantom of the Guild の game について教えてください。
はい。Phantom of the Guild は Phantom of the Guild はストラテジー RPG で一手でユーザーの一手で戦況が変わるゲームです。
So Phantom of the Kill in a nutshell is a strategy RPG game which requires a lot of strategy and one move can easily change the outcome of the battle.
Okay. How long did it take to develop the game?
開発にどれくらい時間がかかりましたか?
About 1 year.
What was the most difficult part in development that took the most time?
開発にあたって一番難しかったことは何ですか？
戦略性の高いゲームなので、複雑なシステムを使っていますけども、モバイルゲームなので、簡単な UI UX を作るのに大変でした。
Because this is a strategy RPG game, one of the hardest things for them, or the challenging things that they were working on is, providing...Creating a game that has a lot of depth with a lot of strategy, but also providing a simple UI UX for the users to play. So making it more accessible from a usability perspective on the mobile devices.
Now I heard the storyline is sort of based on these girls that are kind of embodying are like just a weapon, are now become women and like them embodying the
right. So the backstory is that these ladies are humans, but then they got embedded with these shards of a piece of a weapon, weapon shards, if you will. And so basically they are constantly having to battle each other to regain another piece of the weapon back. So they can become like a full-fledged weapon, if you will. Yeah.
So that's is this kind of like a multiplayer game? Like, do you play online with other people? Is it kind of...
このゲームはマルチプレイヤー、まあ、要するに MMORPG タイプのゲームなのか、どちらかというとシングルプレイヤー系のゲームですか？
シングルプレイヤ
ー。It's mostly a single player game.
Single player game?
Yes.
Now, what other games have you worked on? Like, how did you get started into game development?
Just in general, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. ゲーム開発に関しては、ファンキルが初めてのプロジェクトですか、それとも前から別のプロジェクトにいろいろ関わってきた。
いくつかは経験してます。
He's had a number of projects prior to this game, that he's worked on.
How did he get started then? What was the first project about?
一番最初のプロジェクトは何だったんですか。
一番最初のプロジェクトはドラゴンジェネシス。
Dragon Genesis was his first project.
And that's...
And it's a Japan-only title, but that's how he got started in the gaming industry as a producer.
Okay. What drew you into the industry? Like, was there your favorite game growing up that you were like, oh, I want to develop this game? How did you get started? Like, is that what drew you into the industry? Games you played?
Oh, like, what, like his aspirations?
Yeah.
もともと子供の頃からそのゲーム業界で働いてゲームを作りたいっていう願望はあったんですか？それとも、なんだろう、自分のキャリアのうちがやってる中でやっぱりゲームがに興味があってでゲーム業界に入ったんですか？
もともとはテレビの映像の日本のテレビの仕事をしていて、そこからモバイルゲームだけど日本のテレビだけだとエンタメが好きだったんだけど世界でなかなか出ていけないなっていうところでモバイルゲームの方に来ました。
So he actually originally started his career on the TV production side. He's always wanted to be involved with the entertainment industry or the business. But because of where he was in Japan with the TV production, he didn't feel like that it would be able to take him out to the world, if you will. And so that's why he decided that he wanted to do gaming, and specifically mobile gaming, because it's such a...multinational world at this point, right? It's become that at this point, but he felt that by getting involved in the mobile gaming industry that it would pave the way for him to, you know, break out of the Japan shell, if you will, and like basically expand into the world.
Does he have games that he likes to play?
個人でプレイするゲームは何が好きですか?
Phantom of the Kill.
ファンキル以外で。
個人なんだろうな。
日々ファンキル以外のゲームでなんかプレ
イ
してる好きな
ゲーム。今、まあ、日本での自分のゲームもあるから自分のゲームやるので精一杯で。
As much as he would like to spend time playing other games, unfortunately right now because of where we are with this Phantom the Kill project, he actually has only time to be playing through this game right now.
How's he like in America? Is this his first time visiting or has he been here before?
アメリカは初めてですか？前にも何回か来たことあります。
前にも前のアニメエキスポにも来ました。
This is not his first time. We were actually out here for Anime Expo.
Oh, okay.
Yes. で、次の質問がアメリカは好きですか？
大好き大好き。
He's enjoyed his experience in the States and really likes it out here.
Are you going to be going to a lot of other conventions after this one?
この後他に展示会、コンベンションなどは参加されますか？
機会があれば参加したいね。
If the right opportunity arises, we would definitely be there.
Okay, cool. Well, thank you for your time. I do appreciate you talking to us.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Taiwo Man. I'm here at New York Comic Con 2015, and I'm at the GameCore booth, and I'm talking to Tim O'Reilly.
How's it going? Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you.
All right.
So tell us about the game you got here.
All right, it's called Ultimate Battle. It's really simple. It's a fast, easy, casual party game. Okay, so it uses a lot of creativity. You want me to show you how it goes? All right, so here you go. First things first, you're going to choose your weapon. Pick a marker, any marker. All right, I'll take red. Okay, step two, you're going to draw a little guy, little character that's going to represent you on the page. Could be anything you want. Make it crazy.
All right, so draw.
What? Draw some salt.
Why do you keep putting away your marker?
Different colors. So now it might melt your character.
We got like flying pizza slice. And I got a teenager in a banana costume working in the hot sun for minimum wage. All right. So here you go. I'm going to give you some cards.
I'm dead.
Done.
All right. So take a look at your cards.
Oh, the wild card. You were
fucking.
Oh! What do you think?
All right. So you look at your cards, and it's a bunch of random stuff. Okay? And you're going to use this stuff as inspiration to come up with an idea for an attack. Okay? And whatever you can think of using your cards, the other person has to get out of the situation using their cards. If you can't think your way out of it, you lose. All right? So it's very quick. So I'll go first just so you get the idea.
All right. Check it out. Thanks a lot, man. It was fun.
So you're lost in the woods. Okay? So I'm going
to
put you in the forest. Whoops. Okay, but you didn't realize it's Chernobyl. So you're getting irradiated. Okay? Now using your cards, you have to come up with a way to get out of it. How do you get out of that situation?
With my spaceship.
All right. That's pretty good. So now you draw your spaceship. Alright, and so now as the attacker, I have to decide whether that worked. Did that address everything that I did to you? So I'd say, yeah, spaceship can handle some radiation, take you out of there. So you survive. Now you can attack me back. Alright, using what you have left.
Look at that, it looks great.
I'll attack you with my samurai.
Your sumotori?
In my game.
Alright, so draw your sumotori.
You look great, dude. All right. Where are the girls?
Bathroom.
Oh, of course. Yeah, where else would they be? What's up? What's going on? You want to try it out?
All right. Oh, he's coming right at me.
You guys can play together if you want to try. It's the game we made.
Awesome. He's running. Okay.
All right, here.
So now I got to do something about this sumotori.
Choose your weapon.
All right, here we go. So I'm going to drop oil all over the floor. So he slips and falls and can't get me.
So now.
All right, now you have to decide, would that work? Did that stop your sumo wrestler?
I will say no.
Okay.
He could get through the oil. All
right, so if you say no, and we can't agree, right? Because I could just concede. That's how it usually is. You say, all right, yeah, you got me. Okay, but if we can't agree, we have disagreement cards to solve the argument. So you get right back to playing. So you disagree with my oil defense. So go ahead and pull a card. What's it say?
Resolve. The play with the longest hair is right.
You know what? I'm going to play two.
Well, that's kind of not fair.
Ah! So I think I got you on this one, but there's lots of them. So, you know, the player with the longest first name, you know, or the shortest first name, they're balanced. You know what I mean? So the shortest player is right. The player with the fewest siblings. It could be anything just to get it back to the game. Okay?
So if I survived.
So I survived. I survived with the sumo wrestler. Okay. By making the floor slippery. So now with what I have left, I'm gonna try to attack you.
Or multiple cards.
Alright. So I'm gonna give you a disease. I'm going to give you the sniffles. There's your tissue. All right, and you're going to be late for work, and you're going to lose out on pay. So what are you going to do? How do you stop yourself from getting the sniffles and being late to work?
I'm going to use the wind machine and blow all the snot away so I can see how to get to work.
All right, so you blow it away.
Flags, Julie.
So you can make it to work. All right.
Say this is
it's an invigorating wind. So I'd say, okay, yeah, that works, right? So you've now survived. What are you going to do to attack me back?
Let's see what else. If that's giant. So like you can combine your.
We'll attack you with giant ants.
Giant ants. Okay. Regular ants.
I need whatever you want.
Right. So draw your ants. Give me some ants. There you go. Good ants.
So.
All right. So all I got is a net.
To make a devastating attack.
So if it was a giant ant, I could have caught him. But with regular ants, there's no way. Right? So I concede. So I draw X's over my eyes. And we got a winner. So there you go. There's short, fast games so you can play again. You know what I mean? And you can play with groups of people up to 6 players. So it's a good party game.
Now, how did you guys come up with the concept for the game? Like, how long did it take you guys to develop it?
We've been working on it for about 2 years now. And it's kind of, it started with something we used to do. We just screw around, right? You know, drawing on napkins and like going back and forth. And while we were trying to develop another game, people kept coming up to us and saying, hey, what are you guys playing? Can I play too? And it's like people were interested. So we came up with a way to make a system so that wasn't just messing around. It's got some rules and structure so that the game can begin and end and you can play again. You know?
So you guys working on other games?
Yeah, we've got some things in the pipeline, but this is our first game. So we got funded on Kickstarter last June. We just got the games recently from the manufacturer and we're just trying to get it out there.
Great. Is this the first convention? Is this like the release?
Yeah. This is our first Comic-Con, so we're really excited to be here.
How's the game been doing? A lot of people coming in, trying it, buying it?
Oh, yeah. Everybody's coming in. We're doing great. Everyone's having a lot of fun here. It's really great to see.
Great. Well, thanks for taking time to talk with us. It was a pleasure meeting you.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Hi, this is Danny Calabrese, one of the creators of Ultimate Battle. Welcome to our example gameplay video. The first thing you're going to do in Ultimate Battle is draw a guy to represent you. Here's some examples of what you can be in Ultimate Battle. Harry T. Cat, a bed coat hanger, a ham sandwich. Now, all of these things, as strong or as weak as they are, they just represent you. They do not have any powers. For this gameplay example, we're going to be this kid in a pickle costume. It's got to be hot in there. Look at this clown challenging us to a battle. In order to beat this clown, we're going to need some stuff to fight with. That's why we use these Ultimate Battle battle cards. We also have disagreement cards just in case we get into an argument, but more on that later. So, step 2, we're going to deal 7 battle cards to each player. So let's look at our battle cards. See, we have a bunch of different things in our hands. So what we're going to try to do is come up with the best attack by combining these or using them by themselves. Here's a couple of examples of what we can do with our cards. Using one card, we can attack with spiders. Using 2 cards, we can glue them to the ground and then chuck a big bag of dirt at him. Or you can use a bunch of cards. As you can see here, my turtle used the crowbar as a hook and then tied some wire to it, and then he drags the clown down under the water. For our attack, I say we go with the spiders and see what this clown does to stop them. So that brings us to step 4. It's now the clown's turn to defend. Let's see what he has. He has a bunch of cards too, and he's going to try to use them to stop our spiders. So the clown uses his bricks card, and he smashes our spiders to little itty bitty bits. So that brings us to step 5. Revenge. The clown's now going to use his cards and try to attack us back. He's using the card for bucket and acid to chuck a bucket of acid on top of us. And that brings us to step 6, which is defense. Our little scrappy turtle's going to jump in front of the bucket of acid at the last minute, taking the hit for himself. And then any splashback, we're going to wash ourselves off in the ocean real quick. And that brings us to step 7. Repeat. First player who can't defend loses. So bad. This is going to keep going back and forth until somebody can't defend themselves, and then the game's over. So let me hit the fast forward on this and just play commentator for a little bit. So, kid in a pixel costume decides he's going to glue him to the ground and smack him with a crowbar. Let's see what he does to defend. Oh, the Cloud's deciding to armor himself up, defending himself from the crowbar blasts. That's disappointing. Then he's going to attack back by strapping a jetpack to a badger and sending flying at you. But that seems okay because we've got a bunch of dirt and we're going to throw it into the intake on that thing and cause that badger to crash itself into the ground. So you're going to attack back using some wire and you're going to throw it so it ties up his legs and he falls and he trips and he hurts himself. Looks like the only thing the clown has left is a cactus. I don't know what the hell he thinks he's going to do with that. So next step is we declare a winner. We put X's over the clown's eyes and you have won. Congratulations. Look at him dance. He's having a great time. Now, I know you're asking yourself, what if we disagree or argue or yell at each other or flip a table, get into a Monopoly-style fist fight? Well, there's no need for any of that, because all you need to do is use one of our patented disagreement cards. So let me just give you a quick disagreement card example. Here's our little buddy again, but this time he's decided to dress as a sausage. Kid's really got problems. I don't know what to tell you. So let's say we were going to hit this kid with a mountain of acid. That's a lot of acid. And for his defense, he decides he's going to defend with an umbrella. Now, we could spend hours talking about how big the umbrella is. What kind of plastic is it? What's the pH of the acid? You know, how fast or how big the mountain is. Now, under the right circumstances, he could live. Under the wrong circumstances, he could lose. And that's why we created disagreement cards. We want to see whether or not it's that circumstance. So, really simply, we've got our disagreement cards here, and now we're just going to pull one. Now, let's see what this says. Player who picked this card is wrong. Well, damn. I guess that's not good for our little wiener buddy. And the acid comes crashing down, and he's a big pile of soup, and it's terrible. And he's nothing. Now, I know there's a couple of jerks out there still that are going to say, why can't I disagree every time? Well, jerk, I have to tell you, specifically, there are only three uses of disagreement cards per game. It's kind of like challenges in another game we won't talk about. So that's our game. We created it ourselves. It's a creative, fun party game for 2 to 6 players. We got it funded with Kickstarter, and we're actually going to be at New York Comic Con this weekend. So please come on down and see us. Again, my name is Danny Calabrese, and thanks again for listening to us and watching our video. We hope you get the game, and we hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Hi, Taiwan Man. I'm at New York Comic Con 2015, and I'm at the Weka Workshop booth, and they did a lot of the special effects for the Lord of the Rings trilogy, the Hobbit trilogy, and for Avatar. And I'm here with Daniel Falconer. How are you doing, Daniel?
Hey, man. Good, thank you.
How's the convention been? We're on the tail end of it here.
It's been good. It's been, I always find these conventions physically exhausting, but kind of like on a creative level, really, really inspiring and uplifting. You meet so many cool people and meet fans and meet other artists that inspire you. So I'll be going home really, really tired, but super enthusiastic.
Do you have a fun, which of all those films was one of your favorites to work on?
I think it'd be The Lord of the Rings for me, just because I grew up reading those books. That was kind of, you know, my passion. And I couldn't believe my luck when I happened to end up working at a company that shortly after starting there announced, hey, we're going to be making The Lord of the Rings. And it's like, wow, talk about being in the right place at the right time. That was a dream come true.
Yeah, cool. So what part of... So you're in the design team. So
yeah.
Which characters and stuff were you working on?
Sure. So we all work as a team, and there was five or six of us in the Weta Workshop design team, and we worked alongside Alan Lee and John Howe, who were the conceptual artists that were hired by 3 Foot 6, the production company for the film. And basically it was our job to, between us, come up with ideas for what would the weapons look like, the armor, the creatures, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I mean, super fun, because basically we just sit, a bunch of geeks sitting around the room, you know, debating the finer points of what Gondorian, you know, dwarf or elven armor should look like. So we tended to operate as a team. So a lot of the time you look at the design and it's hard to say that any one person owns it. Obviously everything we were doing, we were showing to Peter Jackson for his approval, and he would look at it and give us feedback. And sometimes we'd be lucky and nail it in one or two drawings, and other times, you know, we might do hundreds before we get close to something that he liked. We'd also work in sculpture. I mean, so there are some things that I could probably say I had more influence on than others. Sting Frodo's sword was one that was pretty much based on one of my drawings, which was pretty cool, and I'm associated with the Treebeard as well from the second film, so yeah, which was cool.
What was the most challenging effect in those movies?
Wow. I think from a design point of view, I'm not sure if it was necessarily challenging, but I had a lot of anxieties around Treebeard, because one, he's one of my favorite characters from the books, and also he's so just like out there. He's so potentially cartoony, you know, you could get it so badly wrong with a character like that, and a film that's supposed to be realistic, and here's this character that's basically a gigantic walking, talking tree. So, you know, it could have gone horribly wrong. But fortunately it didn't. And that look, the guys at Weta Digital made him look great.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty cool. So you also wrote a lot of the books behind the scenes?
Yeah, yeah. So that's kind of my role now, is I do less of the design. And I basically tell our stories. So we create art books and behind the scenes books that give people an insight into the creative processes and all the kind of cool stuff that we make down at Weta in New Zealand. So that's been really, really fun. I get to interview my colleagues and friends and just talk about this imaginary world all the time. It's been really, really good fun. So the book series I've been working on is called The Hobbit Chronicles. It's a series of six big high-end coffee table books, each of them sort of, you know, between 200 and 300 pages long. The last one comes out in November. You can pre-order them from our website, which is www.wetaworkshop.com.
Oh, cool. Now, what's the next movie that
we're working on?
Yeah,
So we've just done a whole lot of manufacture of armor and weapons for the Alliance and the Horde for the new Warcraft movie that's coming out next year.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that should be pretty cool. I think fans of Lord of the Rings should hopefully like that as well. And then also, there's another really neat film that's coming out before the end of the year, which is Krampus, which is sort of a subversive, comedic horror kind of, you know, it looks like a really, really, really cool film. I don't know if you've seen the trailer for that, but it looks really, really fun. So look for that at Christmas time.
Now, I know you were also doing the costume contest last night.
Yes.
That must have been a lot of fun.
It really was. Oh my goodness. And the standard of the entries was so high. I mean, it was actually heartbreaking, because we had people there who were in costumes that were, you know, screen worthy. You know, they could have stood up on in a movie screen and, you know, walked around and, you know, basically as good as anything that we could build, and yet we simply didn't have enough prizes to give to everybody. So, you know, there were people that went home with nothing who had staggeringly beautiful costumes, and I sure hope that they don't go home discouraged, because I mean, everybody was awesome, and there were some that were just incredible.
Now, what films, so obviously you like the fantasy films, but what films do you go see in the theater?
Oh, man, I'm a huge Star Wars nerd, so, you know, I think so many of us are, you know. That inspired me back, you know, I saw those first films back in the 70s and early 80s, and that's the reason why I'm in this industry. Yeah. I mean, I got the chance to meet George Lucas once when he visited New Zealand. Yeah, I mean, he and Peter Jackson are friends, and Peter brought him through the workshop. And, you know, so we all, I was doing my best to play it cool and not be just like start drooling and be a total frothing nerd. But I stumbled through saying something to him. I probably told him, you know, that those movies were the reason I was in this industry, which I'm sure he's probably heard thousands of times. Right. But he was a super cool guy.
What advice would you give to somebody young trying to get into
this industry? Well, I think be passionate and, you know, just be driven and do it because you love it, you know. Don't wait for somebody to give you the opportunity, just do it, you know. If at home, draw, create, make stuff, work on stuff. And that way, when the opportunity comes, and hopefully for everybody it will at some point, but when the opportunity comes for you to be involved in a really, really amazing project, be it a fan project or a professional one, whatever, or something of your own that you've created, then you'll be ready, you'll have the skills, you'll have the knowledge, you'll have the experience to just throw yourself in at it. Because obviously there's creativity and there's energy and there's passion and there's talent and all that kind of stuff, but then there's also pure luck. And I'll be honest with you, man, I got lucky. I just happened to be in the right place at the right time, as I think I mentioned to you before. But when that right time, right place happens, you have to be ready to grab it with both hands and just tear into it and, you know, and take full advantage of that opportunity and ride where it takes you. And so be ready, be prepared, and go for it when you get the chance.
Yeah, cool. Good advice. Very good. Now, any other conventions coming up for you guys?
For Weta? Oh, gosh, I think we're doing a bunch of them next year. I know we've got coming up in Australia, we've got Armageddon. Supernova is the Australian shows that we're doing in November. As far as being back in the States, obviously San Diego Comic-Con, we're always there. We'll be back for New York Comic-Con as well. I don't know which other shows have been announced yet. I'm not sure yet which ones I'm going to go to, but I'll be signing up as soon as an opportunity comes along, because I love coming here, man. Who wouldn't? It's inspiring.
Yeah, you have a good time at these cons. So.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you for talking to us. I do appreciate your time.
My pleasure, man. It was a great pleasure meeting you. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot. Thanks. Hi, Tyro Man. I'm at New York Comic Con 2015. I'm at Isaac Hyman. How are you doing, sir?
Very good, sir.
So tell us a little bit about what... So you do work with... workshops.
I do work with Weta, yes. I'm usually the guy in the costumes. Yeah, I'm a stunt performer by trade. I've been doing it for about 15 years now. And four of those years, I was working on The Hobbit.
Oh,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah.
That's nice. So what other films have you worked on? You've done a bunch of
ones. Yeah, I've done a bunch of different things. I did The Hurt Locker over in Jordan, which won an Oscar for Best Picture. I did about 8 seasons of Power Rangers. That was where I got my start, was Power Rangers. And most recently, I've done a lot of motion capture work. I've got work coming up in Maze Runner Scorch Trials, which is out right now, actually. Some stuff for Jungle Book, a little bit in Batman Superman. But yeah, that's taken over my life recently.
What's the worst injury you've gotten?
The worst injury? Yeah. I had one of the Power Rangers knocked out my teeth. That was probably, it wasn't that bad actually. I actually ended up doing a couple more takes even after it, because it kind of went numb, so I was okay. So yeah, it was those Power Ranger helmets. It's he ran into me with a little too fast and knocked my teeth out.
Oh jeez. So how did you get started? And starts like, how does somebody go about, hey, I just want to be a stuntman?
Man, I've seen so many of the stunt performers, they all have different paths. I don't know if there's anyone who's had the same path into stunt work or into the film industry in general. For me, I was working at a skate shop. I was just doing my thing, and I'd always done gymnastics. I'd always done martial arts. I met a stunt guy who was working on Lord of the Rings and realized I could do this. You know, I actually had the skill set in my background that I could apply it to stunt work. So I put together a bit of a showreel, I sent it around, and about a few months later, I was on the set of Power Rangers.
Wow. Oh, cool, yeah. Fun.
It was great fun.
So So how many years has that been now, Stan?
It's been about 15 years now.
15 years now?
Yeah.
Wow, doing a lot.
Yes.
And you're still doing a lot of stunts.
I'm still doing a lot of stunt work. I still love it. Still my passion. I look forward to it every day.
Oh, cool. Now you're also involved in this book.
This book, actually, it's a family affair. This book was designed by my wife. She works with these guys. This book is basically an anthology of fantasy and science fiction artwork, all from New Zealand artists or artists based in New Zealand. Yeah, so it's definitely a very personal project, you know. I know a lot of these artists personally over the years and being involved in the Wellington scene. And science fiction and fantasy for me is a big love. So this is such a special book, and to be part of it through my family, through my wife working on it, it's awesome.
Wow, that's great. Yeah. That's great. So do you go to a lot of conventions?
This is actually my first Comic-Con.
Oh.
My very first one.
It's ours too.
All right. We're figuring it out together.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. No, and I love it. The people have been amazing. Met so many cool fans, you know. It's incredible, you know.
Cool.
Yeah.
So people want to, do you have like a website if people want to follow you or anything like that?
I don't hide. You can find me on Facebook if you look me up. Isaac Hammond, and I'm there.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, great.
And I don't mind. I have no problem talking to people and answering the questions and things I can talk about. Some things I can't. But yeah.
Yeah, like the Superman Batman movie.
Yeah, I cannot talk about that. And
let's turn the camera off.
I can tell you that it's going to be amazing. Yeah.
Is it?
Yeah, the little parts that I've had a privilege of being involved in. It's going to be a fantastic film. Can't wait to see it.
What films are you working on now? Anything coming up?
We're doing a little bit, Weta Digital's working with Steven Spielberg's BFG, and so there's a little bit doing on that. Krampus will be out at Christmas, and I had a little bit of involvement in that. That's going to be awesome, actually, Krampus. That involves both Weta Digital and Weta Workshop. So you're going to see some amazing, amazing puppetry in that, and costumes and props. And then you also see some fantastical digital work as well from Weta Digital.
Wow, cool.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Yeah, man.
Something to look forward to.
Absolutely, absolutely. The anti-claws for Christmas.
Yes.
Awesome.
Well, thanks for taking time to talk with us.
Oh, you're welcome, sir. Very lovely to meet you.
Thanks.
about never saying never and never being told what you can or cannot do. This is one of us. A 1, 2, 3. Fighting, or when fighting got to me, I looked to find examples on the field of chivalry, and I saw mighty arms, much stronger than my arms could ever be. So I thought perhaps that field was not for me. But still I stayed and watched the fighting till one figure stood apart, in armor newly fashioned and a helm more pot than art. But each blow is thrown with honor and the lightness of the heart. So I took that step which soon became a start. Cause she was not the biggest fighter, nor one to raise a fuss, but I remember being proud that she was one of us. And we might never stand together in a shield wall side by side. Because of her I lift my sword with pride. Was ladylike and lively, not the type you would expect, with a braver heart than many and a slot shot to respect. And I guess she'd once decided this was where she'd like to be, and I thought if she could do it, why not me? Cause she was not the biggest fighter, nor one to raise a fight.